good, busy like crazy, but but it's the last week before I leave for.
Yeah, understood.
Yep, so it's crazy, and I'm helping out with graphics from left and right because I'm not the only one who's late, so to speak. So, yep, for the convention. So, but I'm getting there, hopefully. Yep. It's fun too. So, yeah.
Okay, let's see where we are. Good evening, Ticklers, Tim, Enoch, what's going on? What's up? Hello? Coco Bunny 94. Thank you. Oh, you've been following for a couple weeks. Good to see you. Thank you. Really appreciate that. Hopefully you're all doing well. So I'm gonna say a thanks for one person. Well, let's see. We'll get there. Everyone's getting their. It looks like everyone's getting their prints and stuff. That's great. I'm glad to see. Scala just said he got his. That's awesome. Got some of the last giveaway stuff out for the fundraiser, which is good. So we're in pretty good shape with everything. Getting everything out to everyone. And now it's another week, right, Anna?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it turns
is.
out. Big end to the week. I went from I'm just having a normal three stream week to okay, let's do a special game and then let's kick it up a notch on Sunday night. So yeah, things fell into place, that's all I can say. Thank you, Wiley. Good to see you. Great discussion tonight. Will be a really fun one. So, get out all my shout out ads. I know he's got a presentation tonight, so Curtis will not be on, but there's a lot of others. Let me hit that button. That button. Still rolling here. Let's see if we got hopefully everyone. Well, I'm glad to hear you're getting over COVID, Coco Bunny. That's great to hear, because it's just like COVID sucks. COVID sucks. I had it once. Once was more than enough. Dad, how many times you had it? Once? Big C, how many times you had it? Once?
You mean me?
Yeah, I'm just asking how many times you
had it. No, I haven't had it yet.
Oh, none. Really?
Nope.
Oh, wow.
Not at all.
Oh, wow.
Yep, I've been having
fortunate
sniffles twice, but I've never tested positive either time. So,
well, that's
yep.
good.
Yep, so I never had it.
That's good.
I know with my shots, I've had like 5 shots, but not never had the big C. Yep.
How about you, Mike? I'm like, what button do I hit next? I gotta think. Do I have a? Okay, I do. I have a decent Troll Lord Games.
Join the fray.
Okay, have you have a new one. Oh, look
no,
at that.
No, this is still the. This is one of the old.
Oh, okay.
Ones.
But okay.
It's still, this is the character manager.
Oh, gotcha.
Cool.
Yeah.
You know.
Yep. At least it's not Christmas. It's much more appropriate than Christmas. Yep.
Yes. Yeah. Big C sucks. Hey, there you. No, just a hey, Taryn, good to see you too. Here, Taryn. All right, watch this, LJ, watch this. So I got it in for Sunday. Oh, if I hit the first thing, Taryn, there's yours. Let's see if this works. Boom, 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 boom. There you go. The wonders of the stream deck. Get them in. I was working my real job today, I swear. This will be, we're going to hit some legendary, I mean, literal legendary things tonight. Plus, I have a little bit of a surprise from someone, a legend, wrote up something, and I'm going to share it. A real, I mean, as big of a legend as you can get if you go to GaryCon. Chuck, get me another ad, please. Get it to me now.
He's running behind on that. Yep.
Yeah, they're so overwhelmed right now, and they're short-staffed, apparently, too. They got some... will someone let me know if we get a raid in, too? I don't want to miss Blue Box's raid in, so... And John will be with us on...
Oh, good. Yeah.
Yeah, John's one of the 3 guests. Right, everyone else, I can't. I'm going to. Hey, Pat. Oh, I must have missed it, right? Maybe not. Maybe not. There's still one. No, I got 2 screens on. See, that's how confused I am. Cool. Thanks, Patrick. It's good to see you. Hopefully you're doing better. Hope you're feeling good. Let me tell you something. I wish, you know, I've been at my company 29 years, and because of today, I'm exactly six years away from retiring. I'll explain that in a minute. I'm gonna edit the front. I'm gonna edit the front. I got enough. I'm gonna edit the front. I'm gonna get rid of the reprint, and I'm gonna put this out because everyone does this. So there, because I can edit that out of the viewing afterwards. There, you won't see it unless you refresh. So there. I'm gonna play the Twitch game. Look, we're 6 minutes early still. So you gotta remember, Tim's on Blue Box now, and that could go forever. Like Tim's rounds in combat. Ooh, don't tell him I said that. Tonight, great discussion. We continue on the from one location to the next. Fuzz. Boom, boom. Some great publications there with content. Patrick. It looks like your sub's up, Patrick. That's a rarity. Do you want me, it's gonna take a couple days, but I can do what I said I was gonna do for you if you want me to. So just let me know. Do that finally. All right, look at that. We'll come on 4 minutes early, as I know Blue Box will be on any minute. Get some minor announcements in here. All right. Good evening, everyone. How are you? I'm J.K. Lord Gazumba with me, as always, on a Wednesday's Greyhawk Mike Bridges.
Howdy, folks.
And the legendary Anna B. Meyer. Good evening,
hello,
everyone. Hope you're all doing well.
Yeah.
So, tonight, my gosh, my son's Xbox things are popping up on my screen. Don't you just love it when, like, everything gets linked together via Microsoft, and then it's like, it's all over the place here. So, you're here for the spaceship talk. Well, I guarantee, and Baker, I still got to give you your giveaway from last week. Just remind me, please. We got to do that still, because we really didn't discuss exactly what you were going to get. So, tonight, we're going to do the same thing. It's going to be some classic D&D reprints, please. You know, and then if you're somewhere outside the contiguous United States, I can always throw a Reaper or a Troller Games gift certificate. We got some great ones here, a whole pile of them, including one that I think we'll be talking about. LJ is saying to you all, LJ was one of the ones that interviewed me, Random World of LJ, Anna and Mike, she's saying hello, so very great team over there. This is, I think we'll be talking about that tonight, maybe, so.
yes.
Anna's favorite, yeah, we talked about that.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, I'm going to be honest here, everyone. I got a hair. I did get blowback from Sunday night's discussion.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I did.
Okay. Uh-oh.
I got blowback from two people. I won't say
did
who they
we
were.
Did we go overboard? Was it the style or was it the specific things we said? What was the because it's important to know what kind of, if it's just an opinion we had or if it's more like,
oh yeah, yeah? Get the puppets out. Overwhelmingly, it was positive, but two people said, Why didn't you do 10 Things I Love About Greyhawk first? Or you should have done
that's
that.
That's a good, that's a,
said,
that's
we'll
a good,
that.
That's a fair point. That's a fair point.
We'll do that
yep.
in the future.
Mm-hmm.
And then I blame
yep.
Josh.
Okay.
I just blame Josh Pop because it was his idea.
No,
so.
You can't just blame Josh.
Exactly, Tim. I blamed your brother-in-law. And that's what we did there. So please note, if you've seen the rescroll, I've already had my ice cream cake and all that. It's my 56th birthday today. All right, that's the big one of the big surprises. So yay for me. That's why I said 6 years to retirement. No, Tom. So it wasn't the puppets. It's possible. Yeah. When in doubt, blame Zarathon. Absolutely. Thank you. You know, and a lot of people said thanks via Discord or Facebook or Instagram and via text and phone call. Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, so I feel old actually today with it. And I know that's why Tom hopped on. And there's Josh. Yes, Josh, you caused all that. Hey, Nerdy! Good to see you, Lily. I believe Nerdy Guide is Lily, right? So, and let's do that real quick. We're going to announce this twice. Since we got them, and it's UK time over there, and they're probably going to be exhausted and probably not make the full 2 hours. So let me do this quickie announcement. Sunday night, and I said to Anne, I said, we got to get a DM's roundtable together.
Mm-hmm.
Haven't had one in ages. Oh, okay, cool, Cal. It's all good. Hey, it's fine. That's perfect. Perfect. So, and I knew John wanted to come on. And I got interviewed by Nerdy Guide to D&D over the weekend. And I was like, oh, man, Lily would be perfect for this, being their DM. So I got Lily involved because she's like a fairly newer DM. I'm thinking, who's the third person I can invite? And I said, why not? Because Todd apologized for not, Todd Stashwick. Everyone knows who Todd is now, right? Actor on Picard, season 3, tons of stuff. Played in my game, and he's a really good guy. We'll be at GaryCon. I said to Todd, I was talking to him, I said, hey, I know we haven't gotten together for a game lately, but do you want to come on this roundtable? You're a great DM. I played in your game at GaryCon. He's like, oh, that sounds interesting. Absolutely. So we got it was criticisms, Troy. I agree. I'm just being a pissant. You know me. But Todd is coming on Gavin on Sunday night with Lily and John Birchfield from Blue Box for a great discussion on a wonderful, wonderful topic that will be challenges running a D&D campaign, plus other questions we'll have. So
that'll very cool.
Yeah, that'll be Sunday. I can't wait for that. And then we have a special game on Saturday, but we'll talk about that coming on. So, yeah, so note, we will do a 10 Things I Love About Greyhawk at some point. I promise. There's a lot of other things going on. Because next Sunday's Gavin, after the following, will probably be like a GaryCon prelude show. And then the Sunday after that, I'll still be at GaryCon live streaming from there. So, yeah. Yeah, there's a bonus to armor class with a thick skin spell. Yes. This thing keeps on falling. It's driving me crazy. So, I had a nice night. I had a nice birthday. It was cool. We did a lot of celebrating last weekend. And it went very well. So let's talk about what our topic is tonight. And that is a section of Greyhawk that goes back to like some of the original, unbelievably awesome adventures. So what are your thoughts in a starting statement here? Anna and Mike, go for it.
Yeah, Mike, you go first. What's your cool
about
idea?
About this area. Mm-hmm. From the barrier peaks to the hell furnaces.
Oh, no, uh-oh. We can't hear you.
Mike is gone.
Okay.
Mike hit a wrong button. Mike uh-oh. Wrong buttoned it.
Yep, wrong buttoned it. So, okay, let me continue.
Start it off.
Yeah, start it off with the for me, this is an interesting area because it is literally a western barrier to what we know as the central flannies, so to speak. Not only is it home to a lot of stuff, but it's also very much a barrier, meaning the west of it is not unknown territory, but almost partly not much of the stories and stuff like that is going on. But it's still mentioned in the Paynims and stuff like that, but they are periphery. They are deliberately made to be the unknown land, so to speak. And on the eastern side are all the stuff that we are the center core of the setting, so to speak. And I think that's one of the things. It's really a divider between two, the main part of the setting and the fringes that are deliberately made into to being kind of weird and off the beaten track, literally. And all the exception, but we're getting to that a little bit. And then the other aspect to it that it comes more from me as a cartographer and geography nerd, so to speak, is that it goes from the climate-wise and the terrain-wise goes from the Arctic up in the peaks, especially up in the northern part, the barrier peaks and stuff are truly Arctic and full of glaciers and stuff, and all the way down to steamy jungles and deserts and stuff like that. So when it comes to the biomes and what you can find in these mountains, it spans the whole thing from Arctic to tropics. And yeah, that makes this range. And it's also, I think, presumably one of the longer ones and probably one of the highest ones, mountain ranges on the planet. So it's the equivalent of the Andes or the Himalayas or the Rockies or something in on Earth, so to speak. One of the really main mountain chains, one of the chains, the biggest ones on the planet. So it's truly majestic. And I have it that it's bigger. It's like a combination of the Himalayas and the Andes. It has the length of the Andes almost, and it also has the height and the heft of the Himalayas.
Really? So, I didn't realize it was like 25,000 plus feet high.
Oh yeah, I think it's really, I envisioned it really high because it has been such an isolator, meaning things have, we have hardly any, meaning why would they, someone else come up with the idea of digging a 300 mile long tunnel under it instead of going over it? That meant that it needs to be a formidable Exactly. It needs to be a formidable barrier for things. Otherwise, we would have seen cultures coming over and stuff. The only ones that seem to manage the trick are the giants that seems to just wander over it, so to speak, at will. They are the exception, but we get more to that later. So those are my initial kind of ideas and kind of perceptions of it or observations. Yeah.
That is a mouthful.
There you go, Mike. Yeah. Technical difficulties there are done.
Yeah, there you go. Perfect. We can hear you.
Yeah, yeah, for now.
So what are your thoughts? By the way, another great
The thought is that it's for a mountain range from Barrier Peaks down the Hellfurnaces, it's where a lot of our setting is placed. That's the interest in it. There's a lot going on all along that stretch of mountains. And you can't say the same about all the other mountain ranges necessarily.
Right. I mean, and you can just see, I mean, the Lord Mills are a decent size, right? And some of the others, I mean, this is this is broken up really up here. And you got the Korisks here and are strange going with the contour of the, this is almost fjord-like, right? This is almost like got a Norway feel to it a little bit, but yeah, I mean, look, if you look at the big picture, look at the size of the chain runs all the way out. I mean,
that's a Sulhot. We get to that too, because I have some comments on that one later. But you have all the way from the Hellfurnaces down in the Medio and all the way up to the Barrier Peaks.
Yeah, no, Mac. So Tumahars is in the vast swamp all the way out here. Okay. What are the other two? White Plume Mountain it's a lonely mountain. Shield land, right here, right? There's White Plume Mountain, and then Anna's from Sweden there, LJ. So she's that's where she's.
Yeah, close. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And my mother lives on the border of Norway. She's lived a few miles away from the Norwegian border. So I've been to fjords and stuff many times.
Yeah, very, very
I lived
cool.
close to Norway when I grew up. Yep.
What's the third? Shokanth is right here. Shokanth's in this area here.
Mm-hmm. The Yatils. Another impressive part. Yeah. That is actually part of, if you want to look at it from a geography standpoint, I would include the Yatils in the mountain range. It's only that there is a small gap, the Thornwood Gap in the middle of it. But when it comes to being almost a continuous chain of mountains, you have to go from the Yatils all the way down to the Hellfurnaces in the south, so to speak. But when it comes to the Yatils are kind of separate when it comes to the setting and stuff, because they are different in culture and stuff like that. But from a geography perspective, they kind of include, they are the same. But from a setting perspective and lore and stuff, the northern part is different from the southern part. It's even, I would say there's more divisions to it too, than even the Hellfurnaces and down there are different from the Barrier Peaks, for instance, but even if they're connected, so to speak. But that goes with a lot of the real world mountain changes too. They are very different.
This one's not though. This one's not. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So here comes Blue Box.
Oh,
here
awesome.
Comes John.
Hey guys.
Good to see you, John, Blue Box and crew, as John will be part of that great cast for Sunday night with the DM's Roundtable number 13, lucky 13, Anna, 13th DM's Roundtable we've done.
Yeah,
and,
cool.
It'll be a great discussion with Todd Stashwick and John Birchfield and Lily from Nerdy Guide to D&D. So good to see you all as we're all the giveaway's going. Classic D&D reprints. All right, some really cool stuff. And like you said, you missed it. It's my 56th birthday today. Yay. So I put that on the front of the stream just because that's what Twitch people do. But other than that, good to see everyone as we talk about this really great area. Now, I'm glad you came on because let's just get it out of the way because Anna can't stand it, right? So let's just do it. Let's just do that first. And that's the Barrier Peaks.
Yep.
Where is that crash? Is it right up here?
No, it's a bit north of it.
No, okay. Because you got all these castles here, too.
Yeah, it's a bit north. It's a bit north. Yeah. Up there, a little bit longer, a little bit more.
Well, here's Qualish. Here's Qualish.
Yeah, there
right
you go.
There.
Up there. Yep. Mm-hmm. Up there. I tried to put them away as far away from civilization as possible. No, I hopefully it's not there. So
I thought you had it on the map. Did you take it off the
map?
Oh
yeah. No, it's that you have an older version.
Okay.
And also, it's Barrier Peaks is Dawin Gloin is one, and then Qualish is there, and those are the Mm-hmm.
And then we got to talk about this too.
Okay.
That, we got to talk about that too. Mm-hmm. Definitely.
Isn't it the Unearthly Cave?
Yeah.
I think that one have I.
That's okay. Yeah. It's up here. So.
Yep.
I know, man. I don't look at the official. I only look 6 years older than the actual AD&D. So, you know what? I've done some experimental streams baptized, but not going there. So you know, I just. I know you're joking, but you know, I've invited Amaranth on. She was busy, so I'm just kidding. Expedition to the Barrier Peaks S3. Let's get in on this discussion. An early adventure. This is 1980, really early, and I know that Santa dislikes laser guns in hers. What age are we considered classic? I would say not till 65 plus. I got 9 years to go, dude. That's my opinion though, David. But you know, I could be wrong there, but you know, that's where I'd say it. So I remember running this and thinking to myself, these charts where you figure out what you can do and all with power armor, needler pistols, you have all the fun stuff like you know, the workout robot, were they androids? They were robots. They really weren't androids. They weren't living, right? And all, but they had some great monsters in it, some wonderful monsters. Let's share this now with you all, a message from someone big in the community, and that's wrong, of course. I went to the wrong thing, right here. Posted on my Facebook here from a true legend, Sir Andrew himself, Andrew Scott Perry. Look at all this. All right.
Wow.
This is about the Barrier Peaks.
Oh,
okay. Here's a little expansion history, and he talks about up here, there's a lot to be said about this region of Earth. Now, mind you all, Sir Andrew runs Warp, which is like the oldest guild in existence. It goes back to 1976 of players. And Andrew has a thing he does, and he's going to talk about it here a little bit, which is really cool. Here's a little expansion history. The Bay of Sorrows, it's the kickoff event for my Beyond the Barrier Peaks tournament adventure series. S3 Expedition to the Barrier Peaks was created by Gygax as part of the S series modules. Barrier Peaks is like no other story on Earth. I watched the original play tested Origins and then delighted in purchasing a finalized copy in 1980. After reading the module, I expanded it. Boy, he's crazy, right? No. By adding the other 50 plus starship levels, and showed my work to Gary at Gen Con, who loved it. He ran off with my scientific notebook, which contained my level maps and detailed descriptions. And Patrick, thank you for doing that for David. When we went back up, he had written all sorts of notes and questions, which became lots and lots of great ideas for the remainder of the lost starship Peregrine. Fast forward 35 years later, and Luke Gygax called me and asked me to run my expansion as a tournament at GaryCon. Over 40 years later, approximately 188 players this year will journey through the missing sections of the doomed starship. Here's the intro. Adventure is needed, but not for long. Do you have what it takes to journey the old school beyond the Barrier Peaks? EGG hinted, and that's Gary Gygax, everyone, if you don't know that. The section of Lost Starship found in the Barrier Peaks was only a section. It was only a piece. Okay? And join Warp's legendaries, Guildmaster Sir Andrew Scott Perry, the Harper, to adventure in newly discovered pieces of the Lost Starship. This tournament started with Bay of Sorrows. Runs at GaryCon, GenCon, Game Hole, 20 Books Vegas. And he's going to run this at Virtual GrowthCon 4 this year. So there you go, in October.
Dang.
And I reminded him of that. I said, you did tell me you run this at Virtual GrowthCon 4 in October. Thank you for the in-depth update. I'll share this. I'm at your service. There you go. So, all right, and I will finalize that with him at at GaryCon when he's there. So, Andrew's a good GM there. Yeah. Greg, you play games with him. That's awesome. That's really cool. So, I wanted to share that because we've had a thank you, Glassjaws. We've had a tough time getting him on Gabin or Legends of Lore, right? Because he's so busy. And I would love to get him on, but it hasn't happened yet. We'll keep on trying, right? So, if you don't know what we're talking about, if you're very new, and that's okay, here is the adventure. Now, it's a crashed spaceship in Greyhawk. Back in the day, they experimented, right, Anna, with Boot Hill crossing over into Greyhawk.
And we have to realize this is
Metamorphosis Alpha. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also we today take fantasy as a kind of a set genre with all the stuff. Meaning they were inventing this stuff, so I can totally understand why they kind of wanted to incorporate a lot of stuff to see what stuck to the wall, so to speak, and what was fun. And I can see the appeal in it. It's not something I personally want to do, but I can totally understand if a lot of people can do it. Meaning there's been great movies and books and all sorts of stuff where they've mixed fantasy and sci-fi in really cool concepts. So I can totally get it why they wanted to do it, especially in early days when there wasn't that much content to go around. You just invented it and someone say, okay, we want a spaceship in there. I can see the appeal. It's not something I want to do in my campaign, but it's definitely something I can see a lot of people want to do for a lot of good reasons, so to speak.
I agree, that's
my opinion. Yeah.
Right. So is this associated with Mystara? No. This is Greyhawk all the way, man.
Yeah. And we have Greyhawk to realize, this is also the time when Star Wars kicked off and turned upside down Hollywood and what could be considered a saga, fantasy, whatever. So the kind of the space fantasy kind of thing that Star Wars is. A lot of people see Star Wars as science fiction. I see it as space fantasy, so to speak. It's like fantasy, but in space. And I can totally get it why you want cool stuff in that are related to something like Star Wars in your D&D games, especially since there were hardly meaning the alternative I remember from this time when it comes to sci-fi was Traveler, which is a completely different beast and has very little fantasy elements and hardly even they don't go off the beaten chart, so to speak.
Right.
It's very, very strict sci-fi kind of thing.
I don't think Frontiers was an influence. I think that's maybe Traveler Light.
Yeah,
it might be the other way around. I'm not sure what I might have messed up the time frame, but I think Star Frontier was after this. That's my guess.
Absolutely.
That was my guess. Yeah,
This was Metamorphosis Alpha was Jim Ward's game, and that's the crossover.
Ah, there you go.
Yeah, it's more that. And but this is the early days, right? This is before, and right when I started, this is they're finding their way to feeling out what people want and all. And this is on the top 30, top 10 of all time adventures just because of it being different. And we got to remember, there are so many monsters that come out of this that are new to Greyhawk, that are original, and the big one, and of course I should be able to find it. And you got all, this is like, this and Tomb of Horrors when you got handouts with pictures, this is before digital era, everyone, And this is when you look at this from above the scene, but there's some color pictures coming up. It's going to be sideways, though, unfortunately, I think. And you got the Froggy Myth comes out of here, right? The Vegapygmy comes out of here. Some really crazy stuff. That's an Arumvirax, right? That comes out. There's so many things. Gamma World needed to be separate from D&D. Yeah, absolutely. That is true, and that's a squealer. Squealer, another one that comes out of here. Wolf in Sheep's Clothing. Great monster. Great trap monster there. Wonderful things. At least we get that from this adventure. We get a lot of really cool monsters to be used. I mean, and look, you know, there's, you got your venturing parties looking on top of the ship and all, combat robots, fencing robots, all that. Yeah, and there's the bullet. Oh, yeah, there's a bullet in here. Now, the bullet was not unique to this adventure, but I forgot about, you get thrown out with the trash with the bullet, too, at the end, if I recall. That can happen. There's fighting veggie pygmies. So, it's a thank you, Laser. Keep that hype train rolling. Thank you very much. Good to see you, man. 37 months. Awesome. So, but it's not everyone's cup of tea, and that's okay. That's really okay. But I think it added something to Greyhawk. It added that we're not just we're gonna take some chances early on. So hey, Michael, I think that's what's cool about it. So Mike, did you ever play it or run it?
Hey, Von Molten.
Hello.
Did I ever
run it? Playing it or DM it?
Okay. No, I've never ran it or played in it.
Okay.
Now I've ran the 5e material. It is based on it.
Okay.
And I enjoyed it, actually. Okay. The Lost Laboratory of Qualish.
Yep.
Kind of makes me wish I had ran the first part now, but I'm not sure how well that would have went down.
The Lost Laboratory of Qualish is a DM's Guild publication, correct? Or is that a different one?
It was a charity module.
I think you can still. I think
put out.
I think you can get it on drive through still. Yeah. So, did you ever? So the answer is, I never DM'd this. I played in this. I actually played in this adventure. This is pre 19. This is like pre, right beginning campaign era. Playing in this. We had it was in Greyhawk, but it just was not part of the Order of Ula campaign. But yeah, I played in it. Absolutely.
Now, if I had owned it back in the day, so this is something I purchased later in life. If I had owned it back in the day, oh, you damn well right, I would have ran it. Because I ran all the, you know, anything I had got. I think one of the first things I ever ran was the G series or Tomb of Horrors. You know, it's like,
yep, and this is
right, those were the modules available to
Hamlet,
to buy.
G, Tomb of Horrors, this.
That sounds like an awful thing to start with players on. You know, high level stuff.
Yeah.
Death traps.
That's true, though. I mean, Tomb of Horrors was like, I mean, where do you go from there? I think they made the assumption back then that they were going to convert over your basic characters to AD&D, which a lot of us did.
Now, when we got our hands on Gamer World, we did play that for a time, and I remember enjoying it.
I will say, I played half of a game in Boot Hill, and that was it. But isn't it Alan Hammock's baby, and he does it at GaryCon? He runs a Boot Hill game, Josh, if you're on. Is that
I
on?
Think so.
Yeah, he loves the Boot Hill game. I just don't have the time this year. So I wanted to start off with this. All right, so Mac, you found the Qualish download? Good. There it is. So we'll get to that on some extra things. That's great. Thank you so very much for finding that. The Lost Laboratory of Qualish, which from
it's
Wizards of the
one.
Coast. That's yep. Cool. And 5e. Thank you. Really appreciate that. So all I'll say on this is, I know some people love it, some people hate it. Sir Andrew loves it. Mike Disney loves it.
I think it's good that it's there. It's not something I would have, exactly. But I can say that about a lot of adventures. This for different reasons, but I think it's still good that it's been written and published and all that, because it has drawn in interest to Greyhawk. It's a little bit different from a lot of other D&D adventures and stuff. So it really, I feel, has a good purpose, so to speak, and fills a niche in and just because I don't personally like it, I can really see that it's useful for the setting and adds value. So
okay.
real quick, if you're going to like restart Greyhawk and republish things in a certain order, you would save Barrier Peaks for near last. That's one of your jumping the shark type mods, right?
you wouldn't
start with that.
Yeah,
no, unless you're running like I remember I think it was for it was either the fundraiser, no, it was Virtual Greyhawk Con. I remember that Nightheart Gaming loved it. He did two sessions of his Barrier Peaks live stream for the community, if I recall. And he did the maps. We did the maps all in digital. It's a shame they're kind of gone by the wayside now. Like I said, losing some great streaming partners, but we're going to gain some new partners, and that's the whole plan. So, and thank you all for the hype train. Really appreciate it. All right, so
no glass jaws. I don't think Spelljammer has anything to do with Barrier Peaks.
No, I don't think so either. It's long, long before that was even Spelljammer was even conceived.
Even a notion. The thing that was available was Jim Ward's original Metamorphosis Alpha, which Jim still owns the rights to somehow, which is great. And he's republished it a while. And also another sci-fi thing, which you just see. Thank you, Hager. But you've seen the ads for that I've run multiple times, and that's Jim's Starship Warden, which is even bigger than anything. I don't even know if I have it on here. Let me see.
Well, like Glaz Charles asked, was it retconned into Spelljammer? And I still said no. I don't think Spelljammer would acknowledge that module.
Yeah,
and it's the flavor of it doesn't really isn't compatible. I don't think.
Paxon, they're gone. They were gone once that announcement went out. They were gone in 4 hours. Because yesterday I called Chuck. I was like, Chuck, can you hold me one of those wardens? He's like, they're already gone. They were gone. Yeah, I was like, 4 hours they were gone. The 16 they found in the warehouse. Yep, that quick. It, at $99 a pop. So, yeah, good for them. So that's the Starship Warden. Yep, really. You can probably still get it in PDF. All you got to do is beg Chuck a little bit. All right, so at the top of this, we don't have to, we're not, you know, we can bounce all over the place here. Mm-hmm. We're running the entire length. Skip the Veil of the Mage because it's not really part of it, and we've had Rick Miller on and done an entire area of Veil of the Mage. But you do have...
We can mention a few things, meaning it's one of the interesting geographical... I'm skipping the setting bit and who lives there. But from a geography perspective, it's interesting to have these kind of hidden valleys. It's like you have Nepal and Bhutan and in Himalayas and stuff that are different. So from a geography perspective, I really love the fact that someone came up with the idea of having kind of a hidden valley up in the mountains. I must really appreciate that. That's, to me, is great world building, and you make use of features and not only kind of just make them there, you develop them a bit. So I must give a lot of kudos for whoever came up with the idea, so to speak. I like it.
Its placement and the entry to it and everything, mm-hmm. to me, says that there was some deliberate, reason to that.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I don't think it was accidentally put words that.
Yeah, I agree. I think it was there was probably a lot of intent behind it. It would be awesome if we somehow can get more backstory somewhere written. We'll see. Something might surface. It's not too late, so we'll see. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we've seen. You know, there is an adventure. It's really not an adventure. It's a little bit of an adventure inside a campaign setting, Veil of the Mage, right? Yeah. And then Rick Miller's done a lot of changes on that.
And Gary touched on it in his Gord books too.
Excellent. Which book do you remember?
The later books with the Cat Lord and the Demiurge and Bard Dillingham and stuff. So it's a little bit convoluted and a bit all over the place, but he touched on it. So, but in retrospect, I think it's more like he confused us more than. But this is long after he left TSR. The plans originally might have been very different. We don't know. So it's one of these things. So it might have been that he wanted to. We don't know. Yeah. Right. Since he blew up the whole setting, that seems that he wasn't that keen on developing Greyhawk further in the end of the Gord novels. But it's interesting that Gord goes there and there are things there, which to me seems like Gord could have gotten a lot of places, but he went there. So that puts it on the map in some interesting ways.
So have at it. Mike and Anna, I did Barrier Peaks first because I wanted to show everyone the Sir Andrew writing. Pick a spot. Pick something you want to talk about.
Well, should we go continue? We started in north. Let's continue just a little bit south because then we have the southern bit of the Barrier Peaks, which I think is in some ways...
One question.
Yeah, please.
Barrier Peaks. There's no snow anywhere in that adventure. It's not
I know. Yeah, okay. I know. But the barrier peaks, if they even should live up to their names, they need to be high. And I kind of overdid it with the snow on this version of the map, because the mountains are a little bit too thick when it comes to their peaks all the way out to the edges. But that's the limitation of Bryce 25-year-old technology. So
okay.
Yeah, so it and my Photoshop skills, so that needs to be tweaked, so to speak. Mountain ranges have a little bit less of a high spine, and then they kind of slowly, gradually kind of fade out into it. So some tweaks here and there are needed, so to speak, and it's kind of, yeah. So there's some tweaks in the biomes, and I only have the lowlands, and then it's a little bit color in the between, and then it's okay. The high snow. There should be more, so to speak. I can assume a lot of forested areas up in the north, meaning you have all the climate zones all the way up to the Arctic in the north. So look at the Alps, the Rockies, or whatever. Even if you have almost semi-desert down, you still have, even the mountains here in Southern California have forests and pine trees and a lot of stuff. If you go up, really, it looks like Scandinavia or Alaska at the very top of them, so to speak, just under the snow line, so to speak. So,
by the way, if you want to understand what happened to the Donner Party, just look at the snowfalls that's in that area of California now. They got 5 feet. I mean, I can't even imagine.
I can imagine 5 feet. I've been.
Well, yeah.
I lived in areas where you get 5 feet overnight. Yeah. You have to go out and find your car in the morning.
Oh, my gosh.
And then you have to shovel your way out to. Or you simply say, I leave tomorrow or in a couple of days when it's gone.
It's just.
Yep, crazy. You have a separate door on the second floor, and you actually—I literally been to cabins in Mount. Well, you actually had to crawl out and say in the attic, little window in the attic, to get out because the door was blocked to snow. So things like that happens when it's, but it doesn't happen in California that often.
There's a lot going on in this area here. I want to talk about that at some point. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I think that's the next spot, and I think it's the some of the most interesting parts of the whole area, at least setting wise, because we have all these giant invasions, and now I'm going to put out something that I should have added to 10 things I don't like, but it was on the list there, but it was one of the run up. And he's like, where do these giants come from? That's the most interesting thing, because have a lot of incursions of giants that
no.
No.
All is the reason why the giants go east.
Ah, okay. You see, they don't like all. So, yeah. They must have either passed through all, or they simply mature or come forth up in the mountains, so to speak. Mm. So that's one of the things, is that the giants just come there, but there's no talk or history or whatever of giants living west of the mountains.
Oh.
Yeah.
So explain the giant tunnels here.
Oh, it's from mentioned in it's one of the adventures. I forgot which one it is, because
it's
the
25th anniversary one, isn't it?
Ah, that might be. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think so. If I'm wrong, someone can correct me in chat. I have no problem with you correcting me.
Yeah, and also the mountain names are taken from these modules too, which I kind of like a lot of them. They are they're kind of. That they add to the flavor.
No, really, overall, in the whole world of Greyhawk, there aren't a whole lot of individually named mountains, is there?
I think they're a fair bit. Now, I don't know that intimate details on most other fantasy worlds, but when it comes to like Middle Earth, doesn't seem to have that many peaks. So I think Greyhawk is doing fairly okay, at least compared to Middle Earth. We seem to have our share. Mm-hmm. We have like 20 or 30 or so named peaks that I found. And some of them are like a lot of names. They are inferred. They talk about mountains so and so. We don't know where it is. And also some of them I've kind of added because they kind of should be there, so to speak. And like in the Yatils, there's a couple of peaks that I semi-invented, so to speak, because they're the Griffin Strike peaks, for instance. It's that someone talk about the Griffin Strikes up in the Yatils, and I just added them and stuff. So the placement are often mined. And no detailed map saying that this specific peak is at exact that location. So I took whatever little embryo of hint in the text and put it in the mountain, so to speak. So
what's in this area of the map? I can't tell.
In this area down here, we have, when it comes to mountain peaks, we have
Cloudcatcher Mountain, Bald Mountain, as David says he doesn't like that.
Yep.
He's
and
kidding.
We have Stonehorn, Longtail, Estrald, Rungurheim.
Lots of names.
And then we have Muspelheim, but that's a castle. But I bet that the mountain is probably named after Mount Sessa, further south. But in Grimald is another one. But now we're down in the Crystal Mist. So what are your thoughts on the giants and where they come from or what the heck happened, so to speak?
Why do they have to come from anywhere, right? I mean, it's like
well, they either born there, but then
well,
they are they just
like,
hatched from.
Yeah, I don't.
It's one of me. I
know. I don't
to
need
make
to
sense.
Explain. I don't need to go into where they came to 30,000 years
that's
ago.
Fair.
It's just
yeah, that's
it's fantasy
fair.
Setting.
Yeah.
Wherever they came, you know, giants are there. Dragons, like where are the dragons?
Yeah. If I'm a player, I'm totally with you. If something is trying to kill me, I don't wonder where his grandparents came from.
Exactly. But I don't know. I would just
I'm
say,
thinking of it as a world builder, so to speak.
Right.
Meaning it needs to make sense for me as a world builder, so to speak. But as a player, I don't like, it's time to kill me. What the heck is it? I don't care what its grandparents are. Yeah.
I imagine these giants have been there well before they invoked devastation and rain of colorless fire, and they were a problem with the Sul and Bakuni empires.
Yeah.
Right. And whoever, and the Flan of Geoff all the time.
Yeah.
Descendants of Titans, which it makes sense. That's a good idea.
It does bring up an interesting idea, though. It's like, let's take the frost giants of the Crystal Mist. Are they related to, or do they know the frost giants of the Griff Mountains, let's say?
Yep.
Or is it just like any other, you know, human nations, like people from Zeef don't know anything about people from, you know, Lindor?
Yep.
It's just that
Will
far
says
away.
Cousins. And I'd say it's like orcs or hobgoblins with clans. If you're not of the same clan, and power is the most important thing with to a giant, that they're not going to be on great terms, or they'll abuse each other. You know, but
And my guess is that someone thought they would be great foes for the campaign and the adventures, and they wrote the adventures without thinking of who their grandparents was, and that's perfectly fine. My reason for my criticism is that I think it's an unused opportunity to write cool stuff about where they came from and spin up something more interesting of the world outside, so to speak. Meaning, if something comes into the world from somewhere, that's a good reason to write up a cool story of why they came and where they came from and what might be out there, so to speak.
Giants is a good reason as to why the Sewell and Backlinish didn't run in with the flames.
Yes. Yep. That's
absolutely.
Yeah, so for me, it's more like it's an interesting story, world-building hook, so to speak, that has gone underutilized for decades. Yes. Yeah.
And definitely. Absolutely. Sure. I just, how do I say this without sounding like a jerk? When magic is involved, and everything is not, there's not a scientific answer for anything. Mm-hmm. There's no, we're assuming, is there evolution or whatever? You can explain anything.
Oh, yeah, you can simply say that there's an evil god or something that just invented them. Or look at things like the Beholder. Maybe there was some evil wizard who conjured up one or constructed one or something like that. So you can definitely have creatures like that. And that's cool in a fantasy world because you can have things literally pop from nowhere, so to speak. And we don't even know where the whole world came from in the real world. The physicists are wondering it came from nothing. So meaning even if you are scientific minded, then you have to acknowledge the whole world came from. We have no clue where it came from. So in a fantasy world, you can definitely have giants coming from nowhere.
And Val Moku says, Ymir, right? Where did giants come from? And the two gods, Surtur and, oh my God, what's the other one? Oh my gosh. I should know that.
Ymir.
No, Ymir's a location. Surtur, is it Ymir?
They were born in the armpits and stuff. Yeah, they had all sorts of interesting things back then. In a lot of ways, they were more flavorful than today's science things are. But in a fantasy world, you can come up with cool stuff that are taken on a whim, so to speak. It's just that sometimes you can, instead of just having an empty hook, you can kind of tie it in later to, first it can be just a bunch of giants coming over the mountains from nowhere, and then you can write the story of where they actually came from, or why, or how happened, or who organized it, or whatever, so to speak. Yeah.
So, who knows about Clan Deepholm?
That I think is a Living Greyhawk edition. They added a lot of dwarven clans and holds and stuff like that, a little bit here and there. So in that sense, they changed the structure.
Yeah, Liberation of Jeff talks about all the dwarven clans that are holding out and everything, but they don't even go into any detail.
Exactly, right, they so talk about a lot of them and name one of them, if I remember correctly. So the Deepholm is one of them. Yep.
Really excellent module exposing them. Vamos, what's the name of the module? Just so that people who have access to it,
Deepholm. Let me see if I can find it. Search here. Yeah. Oh, good. Yeah.
Yeah. And then there were several adventures with them. Well, that's cool.
Very Scandinavian names. That whole area, thanks to the giants, must speak Scandinavian. All the names are so Scandinavian that it's kind of someone took a Swedish Norwegian or something book and just started reading from it. So I have a whole one of them is. Let's see here. I got hits here in. That talked about in Geoff various. Oh, there's a whole bunch of adventures here in the Castle of the Cloud Giant Patriarch is one of them. The Caverns, Cisterns, the Birdcage, the Wizard's Tower, so there are Geoff adventures, a whole series of Debt Past Due is another adventure, Forest of Stone. Yeah, so there's a five or six or even more, like six or eight of them. It's a whole series of Living Greyhawk modules have mentioned Deepholm in them.
We're gonna be popping that up at the end for some other ones that a lot of them we discussed in Gallon Gabin, and we went over Dungeon Magazines. We went over a bunch of those adventures, which is great, and we'll show some of them. So my question is was this part of the Geoff Living Greyhawk, or was this the larger area stuff, Amy? It seems like you and Michael know the most about this, these adventures.
Baptin Plus has a good point too. Is that where Swedish Fish comes from? I guess if there's Swedish Fish in Greyhawk, this is probably the area they're in, or the Thelonian Peninsula. But they seem to have
Geoff. Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Good. Yeah, it seems to be interesting because Scandinavian names are up in the Thelonian Peninsula and in the Barrier Peaks after the giant invasion.
Not really.
Full of so the giants seems to be connected to names that are Scandinavian of origin. So the Cold Tongue or something must be Old Norse or something. You never know.
Fruz. Yep. Mm-hmm. I thought Cold Tongue was a dialect of Sulwese.
Oh, it is. So then we have Sulis. It's probably old Celtic or something. And if you want to base it on a real world language, and if you want to have it evolve the same way, then you can use it. Just like Common is English, then you can take the Cold Tongue being Old Norse and Sul then is old Celtic or something like that as one of the precursors of them. So you don't need to mention it, but you can use words and expressions and stuff like that from these languages to build a continuum that sounds kind of cool, plausible in a fantasy world like Greyhawk too. So one builds to another. So
I banned Sulwese on Latin. Well, it's a dead language, so it's a perfectly good thing to do.
Yeah. We have to see what Lord Bressin thinks about that. He's the expert. Yep.
All right. So Clan Deepholm, we don't have a lot of details on, but we know that it's there. And we're still in the Barrier Peaks here. I don't know what that is right there. Is that that's a giant hold of some sort?
Yeah, that's a giant hold. Yep. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's Castle Muspelheim. Yep.
Oh, okay. Muspelheim. And I am assuming that is also from
Muspelheim.
No, Muspelheim's down here.
Oh, okay, you were a little bit. It's the same thing. Oh, yeah, the other one is Castle Tagir, Asael, Mires, Thunderhead, and so on. But they are giant castles. Okay. They have the big log club.
That's it. Sure, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So the barrier peaks, and I always found it weird, and I guess it's just because of my brain, is like, why are the barrier peaks not as cold as the crystal mists? I couldn't figure that out because I only based my head on S3 had no snow, but there's a ton of snow and ice in, and I wasn't even thinking where it is and the height and the elevation, you know, yeah. When I was younger.
But they should have snow the whole way, because especially up there, that's far north enough that if it's not snow, then they can't be any significant elevation to them. And why even call them barrier peaks? Unless the name barrier peaks is more of a satire name, like they were so puny that someone came up and called them that without being it. But they seem to culturally be a divide too. Otherwise, Thornwood wouldn't be that significant if you could get across in many other places. But they seem there's no other roads, no hardly anyone ever venture there except for the giants. So that's why I think that the mountains are significant, because otherwise there will be roads and connections and stuff.
Fuzz,
so it took everybody was. Oh, sorry, yeah.
Anna Fuzz asked a brilliant question. Are the elevations of the crystal mist higher than the barrier peaks?
In areas, I think it is. Yes, okay, I think they are. Okay. Yeah, I think they are the some of the highest.
The Greyhawk guide says the crystal mists are the highest. Range.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. I have the crystal mist and the Yatils as the two highest. Crystal mist the highest and Yatils the second highest, because that seems to be how impressive the lore talks about them, so to speak, in their height, so to speak.
Right.
The crystal mist seems to be the one they talk about as the highest, and the Yatils seems to be the second highest when it comes to talk about how impressive they are, so to speak. And barrier peaks and the rakers, or the barrier peaks are probably a third, and hell furnaces are up there. But Hellfurnaces are just, but we get to that. They are an extension of the crystal mist. We can come to that later when we get moved south. Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Any other points? Qualish, the Qualish adventure that was written for the fundraiser is here, right?
Yep.
In the Barrier Peaks.
Yep.
Okay, Casey, just let me know. We don't have any topic yet for next week. We'll go back to this. All right. So let's head down from the Barrier Peaks here.
Yeah, we're going to the crystal mist.
Yeah.
I think the crystal mist, one of the other things that really sets it apart is that it's much wider in that sense that even it's a bit higher than the barrier peaks, but what really sets it apart is the sheer size of the area it covers, because you have the Stark Mounds and the Jotuns are extensions out of the crystal mist. So they are really, really wide. Just like the Himalayas, you have the Karakum and a bunch of these kind of that leads out that are, if they were separate mountain chains, they will still be more impressive than hardly anything else. But seen against the might of the crystal mist, they might seen as they're not that big, but the Stark Mountains and the Jotuns are probably some of the highest mountains in the Flanese, but they are still dwarfed. They're still the foothills of the crystal mist, but if they were anywhere else, they would be majestic, so to speak, in height. So that makes the depth of the crystal mist really immense, and I put that in there, and because there's like just the center part of it is a massive area of many thousands of square, probably tens of thousands of square miles of just highlands. And that you can hide, meaning a whole country can disappear up there. So you have huge areas of mountain wilderness up there, which I think is kind of cool. And I'm really interested in starting to map some of these areas, because then you can get all the nuances mapping using more modern technology. So you can, and that way you can get a lot of that nuances. You can have huge areas of forest. You can have like tundra and stuff like that up there, so to speak, tundra lakes and various things that will add to it, because that's like the size of Texas or that area up there, so or even bigger. So there is a lot of room for stuff up there. So
side trek, lair of Sophus, treasures of Greyhawk, everyone.
Yeah, we have a good question. How large is Greyhawk compared to Earth? And there have been some in Earth Journal. Roger E. Moore and Gary E. Hulian have written an article each where they're measuring up Earth, and they have Earth as at about 400 miles less circumference than Earth, if I remember correctly. So it's tiny bit smaller, like a percentage or so. And when I modeled Earth, I skipped that change. And I made it I made it the same dimensions as Earth, simply because it makes it so much easier to map it. Yeah, so you can use the same tools and the same projections and stuff like that. You don't have to invent the wheel that much. But in the sources, it's slightly smaller. So it's about 1 or 2% smaller, or maybe even less. It's 400 miles circumference. And Karatur is officially it depends.
Totally different topic.
Yeah, exactly. That is a topic in itself. And now I'm just going on the top of my head. We should have a topic on Karatur, and that's a great topic in the future. But I think when the original Oriental Adventures was published, I think the intent was that it was supposed to be part of Earth or Greyhawk setting. But then since Greyhawk was kind of canceled and Gary was no longer with the company and all that, then later became a part of Forgotten Realms. So, but I might be wrong in that original sense, but it became a part of Forgotten Realms later on, so to speak. So, yeah.
It did come out before, but then something got retconned into. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so.
Yeah, yeah. So that was after Unearthed Arcana. It was the next one, the first edition Oriental Adventures book came out. And hang on a second, I could find it here somewhere, I think.
So MPL, if you want to go to the Living Greyhawk, if you want most up to date population totals of everywhere in here, this is. Right, yeah. Mike, as far as this is probably the most up-to-date.
This is the original, the one that came out, I think, after Unearthed Arcana.
It came out in the mid to late 80s, didn't it?
Yeah,
I'm guessing 87.
Since we're off topic here.
Yeah, go for it.
Gary Gygax would not put his name on the front of something that was Forgotten Realms.
85.
That's how you know it was meant to Greyhawk.
85. This one came out 85. So it wasn't that era after the original first edition books. This was one of the follow ups.
Two are not exclusive. Yeah, I mean you can put it in if you so choose. There's nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm just saying that there was an interesting publication history of Karatur, so to speak. That it was a little bit of it became suffered from TSR internal politics at the times, like a lot of other stuff. So, yeah. No, it's a good question, Justine. It's a great question. Yeah.
We always get the population question, too, which is a sidetrack.
Oh, yeah. That's another one we should have a whole episode about, because it's a very interesting topic. We can have demographics as when we have these kind of academic topics. Demographics is on my list that I want to have. So population level. I think and there is more than numbers that are interesting. And there's a lot of other things. So we should definitely have a show on demographics down the line sometime.
See, but that show, if we don't have Rich on, he's going to argue the entire time.
Oh, yeah. So we either put him on and then have another one afterwards where we clear it up or we So I'm sorry. You know,
It
will be great to have him on.
Because
he thought about it a lot too. So it's a good,
which
good
is
to
a,
have.
Not a bad thing. So this adventure, Swordfare Hero, average party level is supposed to be 18th. And that is this layer here. And this picture actually looks like, I mean, it looks like the dungeon number one.
I think it's the Ken Frank did or maybe it's a Ken Frank.
Flame. It looks like Flame from dungeon one.
Yeah. Yeah. But slightly changed. Maybe it's a Ken Frank did a new illustration of Flame from the dungeon, because it looks like a different image, but it's Ken Frank who used the one that original or something. So, yeah.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of Greyhawk being geocentric either. Earth, I think that's kind of, but then again, what doesn't really matter. So, but gray space is a whole other thing. So yeah, Sulfazikades, mm-hmm. you know, is a And that's just a little thing that's up here that you can find in this wonderful publication, Treasures of Greyhawk. All right. Mm-hmm. So I just want to show
But I think that, the crystal mist is one that is also underutilized. If the barrier peaks, I think it's a good example of what you can do. Use a mountain chain for a lot of cool stuff. But the crystal mist is such a large area that it just became a mass of mountains and no one really did much with it. There's a few places put there and stuff, but I think it's something that you can do cool stuff with. If you want to have yetis and stuff like that, it's,
Okay.
Yeah.
How about this map for the crystal mist?
Mm-hmm.
It's that's backwards. It's flipped, isn't it? Or is it? No,
it's not. It's a good one. So, yeah.
Okay. What's that one, Mike?
That is Vecna Lives.
Vecna Lives.
Is it flipped? Might be flipped.
No,
it's not flipped.
See
it's not flipped.
See
yeah, it's not flipped. It's good. Right, the only thing is that the scale is slightly off because they put the hang on a second. They put Udrankaren and the Tuvag Barugu and stuff a little bit closer. I think I stretched it out a little bit because but I think that was just to get it into the picture and get it neat on the page.
But this map teases a lot of stuff. That's what I like about it.
Mm-hmm.
Like for example, what's the tease?
There's a place marked. This would be close to Jeff. This is the upper part.
Okay.
Up here. So here's like your stairs.
Yeah, I see.
Up here is a place called the Land of Ice.
Huh.
So I'm guessing that's just to be a hint that there's frost giants up there.
Yeah, it's a glacier, and that makes perfect sense.
Well, you're right. Yeah. There's also supposed to be a glacier up there, according to old guys.
Which would make turtles. I mean, it should. Yeah. There should be, yeah.
Yep. And I painted in a little bit of extra white here and there. But
tonight.
Yeah.
I'll post it right after. So the Unearthed Cave is here. Right. This is Barrier Peaks still. That's Barrier Peaks. So as you're rolling down, you do have some other, we got that, Mount Grimald, and you got a lot of mountain names here on the edge.
Yeah, there's a couple. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
and then
that are taken from the adventure that is set, that Sultanate of Arir, the cup of talisman of
Alakabar.
It's the cup and whatever. Yeah, I forgot the name of the adventure, but the one that was published afterwards and
Day of Alakbar.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Where
so they are from? They are from that
Hold
adventure.
Of Gurgur. Here it is. Here's the.
Yeah.
I'm just putting up the giant G1-3 because I'm lazy.
Mm-hmm.
Now
we're getting into that territory with all of that. Come that that's
yeah, so you got all three in there.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yep.
And they mean that you get into the and especially the Stark Mounts and the Jotuns are used a lot, so to speak. It's main, but there's so many mountains, so I can understand why you can't use all of them and all of it because it's such a huge area of. And I think it was convenient to just instead of having an ocean, you just had a mountain range to cut off the setting from the west, so to speak, and it kind of makes sense.
Another thing I never realized until I looked at this, that G1 is north of G2. I never noticed that. I thought,
but take it this with a grain of salt. That is me squeezing them in on because a lot of the locations in the adventures are written as they are centered on themselves.
Right,
the modules don't talk much about where they're set in the world. They are just set. They are more like this is the castle and everything happens around the castle or the hold of wherever giant lord that the adventure is about. But the rest of the world is barely there, so to speak. So it doesn't place them in the world. It places things around
Definitely in proximity of each other because different modules talk about the giants communicating with each other.
And there we get into the problems because people have and various other sources have put them like roughly like this that I've done according in the mountains. But the problem, anyone who's been to Switzerland or Austria or maybe the Andes or the Himalayas know that something can be 20 miles across, but if there's like a huge mountain chain and you have to go by foot or donkey or horse, then it could be on the moon, basically. It's really, really hard to get across. So that's why I think that I need to redo. I need to put some little hidden valleys and stuff like that in, which will be much more interesting when you start mapping this at a more appropriate scale. Because then you can actually have valleys and a whole bunch of stuff.
So let me ask you a couple questions here. I'm assuming, once again, Clan Underfoot's another mention in Geoff, right, for a dwarf. Sturge was not a living Greyhawk area at all. Is that correct?
I think it was set aside for being a core thing or something. Yeah, okay. That's my guess. Yeah, they probably didn't want to have the drowse and all that thing from earlier. That kind of was probably tainted from all the cool stuff that has been there. So they probably wanted to keep it for that.
Wasn't it Vaughn who did all those Isfin adventures that we went over just recently on Gabin, right? All the ones that came out of Isfin.
We had all the cool. It's a classic old area, more classic than Geoff, because Geoff kind of had its heyday in the Living Greyhawk, but Steric was kind of with the.
They did Dungeon Magazine. We had multiple adventures out of Dungeon. I think three. It's a three-parter, little mini arc, I believe, for Isfin. Trilogy. That's what I thought. Mm-hmm. Here's another question. What is, end of the Stark Mounds? There's a lot going on here. I'm assuming some of this is Geoff. What is the purple notation for Richmond and Colerain?
That is a gnome settlement that is underground.
Oh, okay.
That's why it's an underground city. Okay. That's why it's. You remember when we talked in Fantasy Mapping Show about the different symbols and I had the different colors? That's one of the few that actually have a different color.
Yeah, I just noticed that here. Pushing it up. Hey, Kelsey. Yep. So
It's an underground. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Strike Mounds are full of gnomes, it looks like. Yes. And why? Because. All right, so and notice there's lots of tons of open area in the Crystal Mist, just like most mountain ranges, runs all the way down. So,
there's one little note that I did when I did the Crystal Mist, the areas that are at the northern end of Crystal Mist, just south of Geoff, you have a valley that goes up. In the land of Shalf or whatever it's called, where the giants come in, the southern end, southwestern end of Geoff, that goes up into the mountains, and then you have another valley is going in the southwest of Steric. And I actually deliberately try to make the Crystal Mist appear as tall as possible at the end of those valleys, because I wanted to make sure they weren't just easy ways to cross over, so to speak. So that they were true barriers between because otherwise I think the Sewell and Baclunia or whatever would have migrated across there rather than dig under the mount, so to speak. So that's why I made an effort into making them really tall. And there are also a bunch of hidden old volcanoes in the Crystal Mist. I put some craters in here and there. So if you go around there's some here and there. I made little, exactly. There's some hidden volcanoes up there here and there just for gigs, because when I figured out how to draw volcanoes in Photoshop, I thought it was kind of cool. So I started adding a few in the southern land when you get closer. And I also didn't want Hellfurnaces to just start being volcanic. So there are a few volcanoes further north, so to speak, but they're so far up in the mountains that hardly anyone paid any attention to them.
Yeah, there's a couple. Yeah, that could be like Mount Shasta.
Yeah.
You know, it's snow-covered. So I had fun when
I converted a few mountains to become volcanoes. Cool. Yeah. And there's a couple of craters. There are some glaciers and stuff up there that I kept adding. But overall, the quality of the fractals and stuff creating the mountains are terrible in today's standards. So they definitely need an upgrade. Yep.
It serves its purpose, though, Anna.
They're symbols. They're not. Don't take them literally, so to speak. Take them as symbols. So yeah, they were good 25 years ago.
So what's Griffin's Reach? Anyone know?
Hang on a second. Griffin's Reach.
Yeah, in the Crystal Mist.
Yeah, let's see if I can remember that. I need to.
Yeah,
I need to do a search.
Yeah, yeah. Well, hot springs. I guess. Yeah, you can put them near anything with volcanic activity, and there's got to be some, according to. Yeah, I mean, there's a couple right there, so I would say yes. You may have snow monkeys running around. I'm not trying to be smart. I'm just saying
now I can't even find where you saw Griffin's.
Yeah,
beach.
It's north of G2.
Now you gave me a reference. I have no clue about. You need to give geographic.
Never heard of it.
It's north of the hold of Grugnir.
Okay, all so right. We're talking Joff or Steric?
Sturridge.
Steric. Okay, here we go.
Actually, it's almost down near the Yeomanry. It's south of Sturridge.
Ah, okay.
It's southwest,
oh, there we go.
Of the Jotuns.
Griffin's Reach. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
One. I forgot which Griffin's Reach. I need to search for that one and see.
I was just curious because it's way out there. I mean, there's a lot of these in the Aberrals, you know. So someone's flying out there for some reason. Maybe it's just a observation post.
Yeah. It is.
Yeah, it's a sub of Yeomanry. It looks like the path. There's a purple path, which I'm assuming is a flight path, not
it's,
an actual.
It's from various adventures, Geoff adventures. It's actually
really.
It's yeah. Oh, it's and it's mentioned in Dungeon 119, but that might be a false hit. So
okay.
Sometimes it pops up false hits here. So
no
yeah.
Patrick, hope you're doing okay. Let's talk to you soon.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, so it's a couple of LGs. So it's mentioned somewhere, and it's mentioned in, I got a Grand Duchy complete
Griffin's Reach controlled the western pass and the Crystal Mist during the years before the Twin Cataclysms, guarding the Soul Presence in the Sheldamar Valley. Thank you, Calstaff.
Thank you. Yep.
Wow.
I'm getting there.
Where did that come from?
I have it in the Geoff, the Grand Duchy of Complete. It's a compilation of LG Dutch Geoff stuff that someone sent me back in the day.
Wow,
that's where it come from. Yep. Mm-hmm.
So it's a
and there's yeah.
Hold on.
And we also have another. We have an abandoned pass that goes between Steric and Arir. That's
Obsidian
another
portal.
One there. So.
Thank you. I know Gary Khan is this time, 2 weeks from tonight, I will be live with a Gavin because it'll be at Gary Khan, or I'll be, I'll be back from the museum and chatting on Gavin right around this
or
time.
Something. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Or something as it, before it starts. Yeah, it's going to be awesome.
Yep.
So, all right. Well, thank you for that. So it's something against the Soul, which makes it even better. Oh, I know I'm live now, but I'm not live at GaryCon. I'll be live at GaryCon. That's what I'm saying.
I'll be live
yeah. in the Grand Geneva club. Yep.
Yep.
Yeah. Let me absolutely.
But interesting, we have the abandoned pass that is between Steric and Kaibar and the stuff. That is also some old story. So maybe we can have envisioned that as a pass
awesome.
That was in warmer times back in the age. It was probably usable, and then colder times came and it froze over with glaciers and stuff like that. So if there was warmer times again, maybe in the future, then people and animals and critters of Earth can move across much easier, so to speak. So there might be hidden passes here and there that have lost its significance or being kind of forgotten or taken over by some nasty creature in the middle that hardly anyone wants to take on and stuff like that. Meaning there's a lot of cool fantasy possibilities for cool stories and adventures and stuff up in mountains. So, yeah.
So, Josh, you on still? He probably won't respond. Usually busy. So as we move, let's divert and go up the Jotuns and then head for south. So we you have the Jotuns, and of course the legendary G1 is here now. To start off with, the biggest combat that you you know, if you time it right, you possibly can have for giants in existence. And I want to just do a quick shout out here. So if you don't know Bill Meinhardt, he works at one of those, I forget which one it is, Josh, you can tell us, gaming stores, and he's got this unbelievable table. And the weekend before GaryCon, he hosts a bunch of people, including Alyssa Faden and others. And I was talking to him yesterday because he still owes me his character, Anna, because he's playing with you and Ed, right? Mm-hmm. But he has the Joe Manganiello crew, video crew going there, and is going to interview him a bit for his documentary he's doing, and they're going to play. Oh. He has a the same size table, roughly, that I have in my basement. He has the entirety of G1 set up, and they're going to play the next upcoming weekend before GaryCon. So Alyssa gets to play in that. Yeah, I just wanted to shout that out.
I said,
send me some pics, and he says, I really can't because of what's going on with that. So, yeah. 3-5 said that the giant counter room 11 was CR22. Whatever. I can see that. It's like you want to go, and these hip points are, you know, old school or too low. You know, they're just way too low. But this is such a great. And Jason Zavoda, before he passed, always said the following observation about G1. It's only 8 pages long. It's a legendary adventure. But you got like giants of all types here, and you just got a lot of wonderful things and some comedy, of course, with the giantesses and the orc servants and a nasty dungeon level. It's legendary. You cannot wait. We're excited. Same time, Wally. I'm gonna be there Wednesday through Sunday. If you're there through Monday, if you're there Sunday night's the Gabin wrap up show. So there you go, man.
Yep. And giants are really cool enemies too. They're fun and can do a lot of damage and can be characters because they are kind of expressive and they can yell and scream and speak and all that. So I think that they're cool enemies for a lot of and villains for against the party for a lot of reasons. So they're fun to run.
Yeah. In old school, I don't know how it is in 5th edition. In old school,
I ran G1 in 5th edition very recently.
Oh.
And they are bloodbaths.
Oh yeah, and I remember we used 3rd edition with giants, and giants were nasty, and especially at range combat because they can throw big boulders really far that do tons of damage. So they are really dangerous at a distance. I never ran it in 1st edition, but I used the giants quite a bit in 3rd edition and Pathfinder 1, and they were really lethal because they are so good at ranged combat.
I dare say up to, because those. The G series is adapted in the Tales from the Yawning Portal 5e book. And if you play all those modules in order, all the modules up to giants are cakewalks. Once you get to the giants, then all of a sudden you're like, oh crap.
Yeah.
You have to kill me. Suddenly become like this, and they talk about how 5e, so hard to kill a character in 5e. No, the giants could do it.
So as a DM, if you want to reduce that lethality, make sure they don't have unlimited ammo. And if on the other hand, if you want to make them really formidable enemies, you put them behind a wall with a large pile of rocks they can throw. They are really, really difficult to get at. Yeah.
Yeah, it's it can be nasty. But once again, with planning and stuff,
I
just wanted to say that Bill's got it on his table, and I'm looking forward to seeing it. Just seeing he's got the G1 on the table. I mean, that's an exciting thing. So
The way you can use giants, if you want to look at it from a real world, they are basically biological siege engines. That's how you can use them. They can throw rocks and stuff. Instead of having siege engines, I use and others using giants as basically mobile biological siege engines. So supply them with rocks enough, and they can take out even heavy structures and stuff. So that's how you can look at them. So they're really, really interesting from that perspective.
I know the tangent I got off on. I'm sorry. Yeah. In old school, I don't know how it is in 5th or even in 3rd. What is the best thing you can fight giants with?
I would say that some of them probably don't have really, really high saves. So you can get to them. Their will saves and others are probably not that high. So you can confuse them. You can use various things like that. And also if you have, I remember in a Pathfinder 1 adventure, I played an arcane archer. That was the the nemesis of giants, because an arcane archer could cast spells on arrows and do tons of damage at ranges that were further than the giants. So you need a distance. Someone can deal out damage or magic.
I agree, spellcasters, but I'm thinking more on, sorry for the word, racial, dwarves, halflings.
Oh sure,
minus four to hit.
Oh yeah,
giants are minus four to hit. All of them by size. So a dwarf fighter.
But does that apply to them throwing rocks too?
No. Doesn't apply to them throwing rocks. Immediately combat.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, yep.
Does not. Thanks, Calstev. But yeah.
Yep.
Yep. Absolutely. Confusion spells, charm persons. Yep. Mm-hmm. If you, I know you can't charm person them. You have charm.
Giant slaying arrows.
Yep. Giant slaying. Well, yeah. I've seen critical hits from stone giants throwing rocks from 9 to 90 points of damage. So just imagine that.
Yeah. And also obscure yourself, fog of war and stuff like that to make you harder to hit from a distance is also or like fog spells and stuff, things that makes obscure you from distant range attacks is probably a good thing too. So you can use stuff like that too.
Yeah, just putting it out there that I know. In my game, the dwarf fighters tend to have a much easier time than human fighters of the equivalent, just because they're minus four to hit. That's a lot of minus.
Oh yeah.
Get rid of that. All right. So
and just a little side note on the name Jotuns. It's kind of interesting. I think it's coming from in Norway. There is a Jotunheim in Norway, meaning the home of the giants.
Yep.
And it's in southern Norway. It's a part of the Scandinavian mountain range in Norway called Jotunheim. It's beautiful, gorgeous. And was, I guess, in old Nordic terms, it was some of the highest mountains in Scandinavia. So it was the home of the giants.
And all the four movies.
Yeah. So I think it's kind of cool that Jotuns is, I think, a really cool homage. They didn't take the name outright. They tweaked it a little bit, and I really like that. I think it's awesome. A great name. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, I this is not far away from the inhabited lands as opposed to the others. It's really close on the edge of Starich there. And so I was good to see that. Now we know what Griffin's Reach is, and then this is a lot as we go south in the Crystal Mist. This is like either it's weird. Correct me if I'm wrong, everyone. G2 is either your favorite of the three or your least favorite. It's not in between.
Uh-huh.
Most people love the setting for G2 and the ice caves, or they hate it. But there's no in between on this, and a lot of people just think that G3 is really just a slog. Yep. It's too much. G2 is your least favorite. There you go. Amy's is its least. So
and
go ahead. No, go, Anna.
I was going to say, Jobri has a cool. So giants are canonically hygge. That's a Danish expression for being laid back, and it's kind of cool. That's awesome. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I liked it. I thought it just. I don't know if. Well, they should be disorganized. They're very chaotic. I love that they had all the frozen bodies in the one room, and G1's, but I love the Rimarazin. The Rimarazin is the ultimate trap, just lying there underneath. You don't even know about it. It's awesome.
And Rimarazin is one of the. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
I was going to say Rimarazin. I'm just going to say, I think it's an excellent monster. I really like Rimarazin. Yeah. That they have enough fantasy feel, but they still feel grounded in the world to me. So they are that kind of really that they are perfect mix between real world monster and make believable and fantastic, so to speak.
Yeah. So and there's a dragon in G2 too as well. So they are all So and the
Earl's cool, Distinius. Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Oh, Jotsplat. Cool. Justinius is no. You don't have to tell me if it's a spoiler, but is it Carlos's adventure you're running up there? And there's a Remoraz in it. I have it. I just haven't checked it out. So.
Yep. Yeah. And I also like the idea of dwarven bobsledding teams. that sounds awesome.
That's amusing, Sam. That's really amusing. So, all right. Another great legendary adventure.
Yeah.
One D&D discord to play this one. Really? Huh. Has a lore page and they start with a rundown. So I'm going to ask the same question that got asked of in the office. Give me a rundown. What the heck's a rundown? Like, is it two paragraphs there? A history prof? Is it a couple pages? That's a good question. I want to know. Drop a link. Sure. Drop a link. So, hey, Rock Frog. Yes, you always need to make your players happy. They deserve it. They deserve to be happy or dead. Okay. Yep. I agree. All right. So, as we continue downward, it doesn't look like there's... What's this pass of the clenched fist? I never noticed that before. What is that?
Yeah, there's some.
It's got to be from another map of Alec Bar.
Oh yeah, that's it's the Griff, the Sefnoy Highlands and stuff. Yeah, they're from. I'm sure which one, but now we're talking Paynims and Western stuff, so to speak. So that's my. On that side of it, so yeah, and to me they are shoehorned in. I just put them there basically because they were supposed to be in the area. The terrain doesn't really match it, and there's a lot of and when you look at it, you have a lot of these dead valleys that are basically surrounded by mountains. It doesn't work like that in real world, so to speak. Only in dry moonscapes where you have no water, no atmosphere, no erosion, things like that. Pops up, so that definitely needs so that needs to be developed. And now when I look at the mountains, I think they look terrible, but it's so that need a lot of things like that needs to be fixed. And then you have places like in the eastern Sulauts, you have the Chepnoy Highlands and a bunch of them. And the Sulhout, let's mention them real quickly before we get on the eastern side, because that's, to me, I made them way too impressive. And I think I made them way too impressive, because remember that this is the area where the Baklunish and Sul were supposed to fight the war between themselves. And if you have the Himalayas between you, I don't think you need to fight wars unless you more in modern times, so to speak. In a fantasy culture, you probably don't need, you don't squabble with your neighbors across the biggest mountain, one of the biggest mountain chains, so to speak. So I need to tone it down, so to speak. I can keep the width of it, but it needs to be down, and there needs to be passable valleys and stuff across. So that's something I definitely want to look into in a future mapping. I just wanted to mention that because I think it's kind of a bit too impressive. And I think one of the reasons it's become more impressive afterwards is that the Sea of Dust, I have that area subsided. It sank down. And that way from the north, the Sulhout is not much to speak of at all. But if you come from the south, they are much more impressive. And that makes a lot of sense. So before the Twin Cataclysm, the Sulhout was the high hills. They were like the Lort Mills or something like that. That's what I envisioned them to be. And that means that if you see them from the Dry Steps area, they're still Lort Mills. Kind of, but if you come from the south, they are much higher and much taller. So that's really my quick take on the Sulhout, because that's one of the extensions. And another thing is that it's kind of unique to have these enormous mountain ranges going like a T like this. It doesn't really happen in the real world real world plate tectonics. Exactly. So we don't we get these that branch off like more like the Jutens and stuff like that. That are simply they are like it, once you have something that gnaws against each other, then you get these that folds up on the side, so to speak. That happens in the real world. But to have a major mountain chain take off in a different direction like that but it's fantasy. So we can have fantasy plate tectonics. So we can, I just wanted to explain the difference there. We can definitely take the creative license and look at Middle Earth. They have these square, Mordor in Middle Earth is kind of squared in by mountains like that. So there's a good precedence in fantasy literature. And cartography for mountains or world design. So even Tolkien himself did that. So we can definitely, there's precedence for it, so to speak.
So Kalthus.
Oh, Rich. It's called the Sewell Hots because the backlunners put up as a warning. Sewell are hot. They're on fire.
Ah, there you
go. Don't go there.
Good point. Yep, great point.
Kalthus, is that the adventure with the super high-level mage with Lord Fell in it, or is that different? Yep. Because I love that one, Threshold of Evil. I've run that, but I put it in Lord Mills because it's just for my campaign. Sam brings up a point, Anna. You can have the mountains like this, but there should be more passes through it.
Exactly, that's what I meant. They should be more passable. Yes, yeah, and also I must say, Goblin of Gaxinor, I agree with you. I don't like the design of Mordor and the mountains around it much either. It looks way too boxy and stuff.
If they made it rounder, they could have said it was a meteor strike or something, right? Just thinking out loud. All right, so but that gets us down in the Crystal Mist here. Oh my gosh, it's only 9:25. Where'd the time go? Holy jeez.
Yeah, you see, we babble about interesting stuff and time flies. Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. So let's we continue on. There's a lot here. Yeomanry, exactly. Sorathan's Tunnel, the Dark Gate. Here is, all right, it's an argument for a lot of you. Return to the Keep on the Borderlands is here. You don't have to keep it here. It's kind of cool that it is, though, but that's where it is. Yeah. Kendall Keep.
Let's mention it. In the first adventure, Keep of the Borderlands, it wasn't named and it wasn't placed at all. And then comes Return to the Keep of the Borderlands when they named it Kendall Keep and they suggested it to be here. And one of my philosophies, I mention places as they are named in adventures. I don't name the place after the adventure. If there is a Kendall Keep or a town so-and-so in an adventure, I put the town and the keep there. But thankfully others have done module maps where they placed modules on this thing, and I've added a few. But my naming convention is that I name geography places, so to speak, not adventure modules. So, but that's me being a geography nerd or anal about it, too anal probably for a lot of people. But so Kendall Keep, there is the Keep of the Borderlands according to the Return of the Keep Borderlands. Their suggestion where you put it, but it's a cool target rich environment. The geometry is underrated. It's being used more than we normally think, so to speak. It's a lot of cool stuff. Dark Gate was developed during LG times to cater to the Sclerotin tunnels. It was not there originally. It's I don't know how long, but it was invented in LG times and they added it. So yeah.
That's easy. Camden of Earth is Divers by far, History Prof. What a shithole. There you go. So, the passage of Sloratin, I know there's an argument, but didn't Leonard partially come up with that?
I wouldn't be surprised at all if he did. And I think it's one of the cool things, and it's on my mapping to-do list, or my wish list, so to speak, that and now I'm starting to, I haven't made any, and I'm not going to show any concept at GaryCon, but I'm starting to figure out how to do it and how to map, because we're talking about a dungeon that is 300 miles long. And that means that you can't use regular dungeon methods, so to speak. It's like mapping a landscape, but underground. And I'm starting to have some ideas, and I've run some tests, and they're promising. So I want to tackle, and it's one of the things I really want to do, is to map the Sclerotin tunnels. That will be an epic project I want to do. I really, really want to do it.
For those and of have, you yeah, that are lazy, sorry. Like myself...
You're not lazy.
And Dale, and probably Von Moku, maybe. Caverns of Thracia is perfect as to go here. The Judges Guild one. You can fit it right in this area. Yep. Yeah. So, CMPL. Yeah, that's a good place to place it. Yep.
I think it's one of these that really deserves to go deep into. And I want to, And I want to present the geography of it, so to speak, of the Sclerotin tunnels, and because I think that there must be a lot of natural caves as well. It was not, they didn't drill or use spells to go 300 miles through straight through the mountains. So I think we can, there can be some cool underground geography in that area that we can kind of rely on as well.
It's like the Mines of Moria. How many miles across was that? Mm-hmm. I don't think it was 300. I think it was
it's big. You have you can have extensions and whatnot, and also. There might have been things that have moved in the last millennia it was created, meaning it had 1,000 years. There's a lot of Umber Hulks and all sorts of nasty creatures and things that can have shaped it since. So my intention will be first do the natural caves and then add Slerothin's effort to combine them using various methods, magic and digging and whatnot, and then add all the stuff that have come after, so to speak. So that will be my approach to it.
So, cool. How do these undermountain tunnels compare to real tunnels in Europe's mountains? I don't know.
They are longer than anything we've made to date. I think the longest. I think it's 100. They are now making a tunnel under Switzerland. The Brenner tunnel is 10-15 kilometers, but I think they're working on something that is closer to 100 kilometers that is going under between France and Italy, and that one is really far. They're digging deep, and that's with modern day tunnel boring machines and blasting and whatnot. So Slerotin's tunnel will be almost impossible even with today's engineering. Exactly, longer talus, you're onto something. So it's a truly. But on the other hand, if we have divine intervention, magic, and various creators that can dig underground, it could definitely be feasible. So yeah.
All right. So let's as we continue down here. Here's a mountain has his own area on the map.
Yes.
Alcacia.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. We go further south here, and you got most of the UK modules here, including the legendary gargoyle. Be thankful.
Yep.
Be very very thankful.
Yeah, and we also have another name, the Taurus. I really like that too. It's a lot of good names here. I like that as a name for that little extension that juts out there, so to speak, the Taurus. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yep.
Can't follow Pithus. So, yeah, it could be any number of things. Yeah, an old river that flowed through. Yeah, a lot of options there. But as we continue south into the Hell Furnaces, the Hall of the Fire Giant King looks like it's right on the border where the crystal mists, according to the way this looks.
I put the border up to where that was because for thematic reasons, so to speak, I thought that a fire giant should kind of settle where the volcanoes start. Or maybe they cost the volcanoes and stuff. I don't know. That's something you can, each DM, you can decide. Do the fire giants settle where the volcanoes are, or are they literally creating them as needed, so to speak? They might want some central heating or something. Yeah.
So that means that 40 miles Kara's Derm, that you guys also got to remember, the low road that that David and Rich have worked on is, you guys ever measure it? It's got to be 500 to 1,000 miles long.
Oh, yeah. There's some of these are maybe too big when it comes to it. But on the other hand, Greyhawk Adventures had I used tunnel from Dorakar to Greyhawk. So under near the lake near Durb. So there's been more ambitious projects than either the Slerothin tunnel or the low roads. So there's been some epic engineering in Greyhawk. So that are lore, so to speak.
Here's the thing. Once you get past the Hall of the Fire Giant King, there ain't nothing. There's some
not
stuff.
Much. It's not much. There's an ancient Sewell temple. And then you have the Sanctuary of the Fallen Stars, where the Order of the Bone hangs out. And
who hangs out?
The Order of the Bone. I added the heraldry to that later on.
Okay.
It's one of the skull heraldry with red background, so it's kind of hard to make new versions of. And skull seems to be very popular, so when it comes to heraldry. And then there's some more. We have the Temple of Aumata Perion, Windgate, Ashmire. The Wind Valley, that's from another British adventure, I think, from a UK adventure, if I remember correctly. So there are some things, some weird things that, but from a cartography perspective, it was the most interesting. And I waited with Hellfurnaces is among the last things I did on this map because I felt that I didn't have the skills and the tools until very late. So it's one of the last features I did on the map.
But there isn't much. Go ahead, Mike.
No, it's not. But it's in that sense, it's some of the stuff that I like the most because those volcanoes, I think that there are a lot of lava lakes. I love the smoke above it and stuff. So from a cartography perspective, I think it's some of the highlights of the map.
Where's the tunnel that was made for the Sewell to scurry through with their tails between their legs from the Bicaloni? That's there goes Troy. So here's what does that say? That says what? So that's not the Had.
Oh, hang on a second.
Hadarn.
So yeah, that, yeah.
Cauldron's part of that, not part of the Hellfurnaces. Okay.
No, it's kind of an offshoot, like Jotuns and the Taurus and stuff like that is one of the offshoots.
Right,
so yeah.
All the UKs are here except when a star falls. They're all in here or up here. That's Gargoyle. That's not a UK. Sorry. I panicked.
It's the Hadarnar range. Yeah. That's the and there's a few mountains. That's from Sassarine and the Cauldron on
Cauldron and then you
adventures.
Have Savage Tide, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sassarine Savage Tide, yeah.
So but it is pretty much like you have a lot of dotted stuff, I guess because there's no
We don't have Greyhawk, much develop. Yeah, exactly. There was no Living Greyhawk adventure setting that area. So it's very lit. There's a few UK stuff and a couple of other, I think it's Dunyan adventure or something like that, or something that was set down.
This one's called the Tegafed Mountains right here?
Yeah, those names are kind of German, kind of weird. Tegefed Mountains. So it's kind of a riff of German, just like the Jotuns and others are of Norse. So you have the Kampf Mountains and like the Fighting Mountains, if you translate them, or War Mountains.
Okay.
And Berghof is very, it's a lot of these are German sounding names in little bit there. So, yeah.
All done in UK adventures.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah. So
I even took away a couple of names that I thought were too odd, little way and stuff like that. I thought they were kind of, I don't know. It's kind of sometimes I have a difficulty if they get too close to home. But in Pearland that were LG, they put some names up there, and I see you on the Berlin subway, and I was like, no.
So there's a couple things in the Sea of Dust down here. Temple.
There's a couple of stuff there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. There's a few things there. So, and I forgot where they were mentioned, but some of them are from Gary's Sea of Dust, and some of them are mentioned in maybe a couple of other sources. So, yeah.
It's all good. Mm-hmm. All right, Mike. So, what do you want to bring up in all this as we run the gamut length of this?
I just wanted to comment on the Darlene map. There are several volcanoes labeled on there, right? Are those on your map, Anna, locations of active volcanoes?
Oh yeah, and I've added way more of them, so to speak. I just had a field day when I figured out how I can make volcanoes in Photoshop. I kind of, oh, this is so much fun. So I probably drew in a few too many, so to speak. So I had a volcano thingy, and that was actually the same time I did that was the same time I had to do volcanoes for Southlands for Cobalt Press. So I kind of realized I need to I wasn't sure how to do it, and I didn't know Photoshop. I was just starting to know Photoshop deeply, so to speak. So when I figured out how to do it, and it was a lot of fun, I just went wild with it. So it was a volcano week or volcano month, both in the Flannies and in the Midgard at the same time with Southlands. So that was, it was kind of funny because late in the Southland project, all of a sudden Wolfgang said, oh, we need some more volcanoes. We only have one. So I had to invent volcanoes a little bit here and there. And then I said, and then I've started to figure out how to do it. So let's do Hellfurnaces. So I did them at the same time. So back in 2012 or something like that. Think it was.
It's
so
cool.
So it's yep.
Yep. All good. So if we go to the very top of the barrier peaks up here, you have Sisypros Erd, right? Mm-hmm. And that is, I just brought it up. That is in Greyhawk Adventures, page 97. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Greyhawk Adventures.
Yep. And it talks about the last of Euros and Jebli tribes when they were driven. This is the hateful wars. They tried to reach the atolls and couldn't. And so this is there are a lot of geysers here. Why here? And not other places, do not know. But there's poison gas running throughout. Odorless and colorless, acts as a cloud kill, and you know, the geysers could erupt at any point, so it's kind of Yellowstone-ish on steroids. You know, and there's just, you know, because it kills so many, there's just treasure strewn all about. Another one of those areas that, you know, you go at your own risk here.
Yes, I'm lovely. So.
Yeah. It's remarkable for the number of bones in it, many now encrusted with minerals from the hot springs. So, yep. And it says that there's giants in here still. Giant ravens and eagles. So, yep. So, very cool. That is one of the locations in Greyhawk Adventures. Also in Greyhawk Adventures. What were you going to say, Anna? I'm sorry.
No, no, please. Continue.
Also, there are some items here.
A lot of items.
Yes. Pick one out, Mike. I know you probably got a list.
Horn of the Barrier Peaks.
Yes, Horn of the Barrier the Peaks. Isn't there a headband of Jotuns right there too, right next
There's
to it?
There's a headband, yeah.
All right, so let's go to those. So these are the Horn of the Barrier Peaks. Here it is. All right, so you got the iron instrument was enchanted by Dwarven Smith to cement the friendship between demihumans and giant eagles. So, and it can summon them. It can summon giant eagles.
So you get the one ring, you blow the Horn of the Barrier Peaks.
And
you're done.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yes. So once again, we've asked multiple times, and unfortunately, you know, Jim Ward doesn't know who wrote what here because it was so fast. I would have loved to have gotten that, but that's not. So here, the headband of the Jotuns. This strip of elk fur was enchanted to ensure the safety of travelers in the Jotuns. The item allows its wearer to understand the psychology of hill giants, which is kind of strange a little bit.
It makes perfect sense if you consider that's where the hill giant chief's at.
True, but
you have that item, then go there, that changes that module completely.
Right, this is an item you don't want. This is an adventure-breaking item there, but if you're traveling through for some other purpose, yeah, absolutely. What other ones are here, Mike?
There's a cloak of the Hellfurnaces.
Yes, there is.
Which does pretty much what you would expect it to do.
Fire resistance.
Protect you from fire.
Here it is. Yeah. Created by a wizard who sought treasure in the volcanic mountains, this magical red garment provides protection against many of the volcanic dangers and gives protection against similar danger from other sources. Half damage from heat and protects you from sparks and hot ash. A plus three saving throw against inhaled poison, too, which is interesting. Poisonous, yeah.
Well, it's a lot of, volcanoes are very poisonous, even in the real world. So,
Yep. What else we got?
Then we got a couple suits of armor. The blue armor of the Chrysalis and the red armor of the Hellfurnaces.
Yes. And am I going the right way?
Which are both dragon. Right. It's dragon armor.
Dragon armor. Whoop, it's last. Sorry. Well, I went by it. Tapestry should be down here. Whistle armor. Blue armor to Crystal Mist Mountains. Yep. Chainmail plus three. So
electricity. Yep. Resistant.
Saves electrical for half damage or none. And then, they just added stuff.
Back in second edition, my friends were really big into making armor out of dead dragon bodies.
Yeah.
So if there was a color or a shade or something like that, they probably had a suit of armor on it. They had like a whole closet full of dragon armor. It was stupid. Monty Hall campaign. But the fun part of those armors, like it says in Greyhawk Adventures, if the red dragon sees you wearing that, then they get out, mad.
Oh, so sure.
It's like one of these, look at me.
You're wearing the skin of, So, and this one's plate mail plus four. Wow. Half or zero on this one. Holy geez, this is even more powerful than the other one. So, Red Dragon Seen's Armor make unusual efforts to kill the wearer.
You give a character that suit of armor, then you play Hall of Fire Giant King. That changes that completely as well.
Absolutely. Okay. Very cool. That book is awesome. Yeah, yeah. There's.
But I love those items.
So yeah, baptized. There's all para. There's a ton of different types of para elementals, and also mephits. There's all those kinds: smoke mephits, magma mephits, everything. Anything you can think of. Salt mephits.
Yep.
Yeah. Fun stuff there. So. Mm-hmm.
Now another thing that Greyhawk Adventures has is the crystal mist.
Yeah, the chrismals or the crystal mist.
The crystal mist. There, it's a crystal swarm that inhabit the Crystal Mist Mountains, and so like one may have given the other its name.
Oh, okay. What page is that on, Mike?
It's in the monster section. I don't know.
Okay, it should be coming up here.
But I've never used them, but they make fun reading.
They're different than chrismals, crystal mists, and great point there. Here they are. The crystal mist. Yes, here they are. Yep. The crystal mist is a swarm of living crystals that dwell in high mountainous regions. When threatened, the individuals in the swarm can combine to form a community with intense intelligent powers. It's almost like a syphil, but that is, for Fiend Folio, but that's with insects. So an individual crystal mist creature appears as a tiny drifting crystal, like a large snowflake. Interesting. I've never used them either, Mike. That's cool. Yeah.
Always thought that was interesting, to have a creature thing named after a geographic region.
Definitely. Note that even though another point, and you have the Greyhawk Dragon in here too, which is awesome. But the, Sword Race, it says Stark Mountain's Undead Spirit, but I use them from almost anywhere.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. Absolutely.
But, yeah, having a unique undead or some kind of creature from a region is kind of thing you do to give it flavor.
Oh, definitely. For sure. Definitely. There are some great... monsters that originally were Greyhawk. I know they've been used a lot of places, but I rarely see sword base or drowned ones. I know that those crystal mists, I've never seen them used, period. But a lot of the other ones are.
They're the opposite from drow that appears everywhere. And now you have the younger race. So Greyhawk has them too. I said, no, Greyhawk had them first.
Greyhawk had them first, absolutely. Yep. And be forewarned, if you're going to do G3, you're going to do it forever and ever and ever, right? It's a long, long third, and that you get introduced to a Calavdra in it and the Drell.
I got burnout after G1 and 2. I was just burnout after that.
You've seen enough giants.
Take a look. Yeah. Let's go here and show some of the other ones in this area that are their adventures here, all strewn out. A lot of these we went over on Gabin, like Giant Killer. I know we went over that one. That's a super high level adventure. There's Expedition of Barrier Peaks. The thing I hate about this is it covers it, and then I got to move it. There we go.
But that's a great intervention to have that way you can put why modules are set and stuff. That's a great one. So I really appreciate that.
Imaginations are here.
Yeah.
These are all going to be, they're all the D series. Remember, we didn't even talk about the Underdark part of this. Mm-hmm. We didn't have a chance.
Well, they're adjacent, so to speak. Yep.
Whoops, I didn't mean to do that far away. I'm just trying to get it so I can see over it again. So in Sturridge, you have all the series, the Abyss ones by Greg Vaughn, right? That we went over a couple weeks ago. There's three of them here. I don't know if I'll be able to highlight all of them, but yeah, all three are there in that area. Headless is here, another one we went over. Soul Sucking and Sterich. So there's G2, G1, it's all the drow ones there. Okay, let me go over here and go. Oh, I went too far. Yes. You got one or two more? All right. I'm just trying to get back over here. There we go. Kingdom of the Ghouls there?
Is that Hellfurnaces?
Yeah, Hellfurnaces. Yeah. Yeah. Kingdom of the Ghouls is in Hellfurnaces, right? Yeah, and that's that. You know, that's a fifth edition entirety Monty Cook now. Yeah, that's a so. Well, jeez, my gosh, Queen, right, Underdark stuff. All right, what's this? The Last Slave Lord. Wow, I know that's a fourth edition, right?
Is that's that where on Jekyll Coast, right?
Yeah, wow, that's where that takes place. I know that was a fourth edition adventure, correct? Heart of Hellfire Mountain takes place right here.
Okay.
We didn't discuss that one yet because it's a Savage title in here. We didn't get that far. So, yep. Let's see what this one is. We did, yeah, it's Stormlord's Keep. We talked about that. So there you go. So there's a lot of other ones. There's Kendall Keep. Return to Keep on the Borderlands. House of the Brothers is right on the southern tip of the Jotuns. That's an early dungeon, real early.
Yeah.
Yeah, very early. Let's see what this one is here. And this is there's another Carlos adventure, The Forgotten Library of Rannet, which is supposed to be what, Anna, its equivalent? Anyone, please let me know what the equivalent of that is in that area that Carlos is paying homage to. Rannet, the Soul Goddess, thank you. Thank you very much there, Rich. You're useful for something. I'm just kidding, Rich. That was awesome. Good to see.
Yeah.
Really appreciate that. All right. There's a lot of other things in the area. Killed by Paremius. All right. So it's like dead knowledge. Very cool. Oh, that would be a good one to run. What level is it for? 5 to 7. Perfect. Perfect level. I'll have to take a look at that one. C12. I don't think I have it. That's one of the ones I don't have. So... You ran it? Did you like it? Soul Guards of Long Cards. That's funny. That is funny. Mike, you ran through that one?
Yeah.
Did you like it?
Ran me through that. So, oh, Long cool. Corridors. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, there are Long Corridors in the adventure?
Oh, I'm no longer in any other old school adventure, I guess.
But I'm saying...
On Rich's maps, they felt extra long.
Okay. Ready to run it in your regular games. Always got to tweak stuff for your campaign. So, and please note, once again, this is available anytime on Cannon Fire's site. Anyone can go there. Just sign up. Just become part of the Cannon Fire community or the Cannon Fire Discord. Right? There's Cannon Fire Discord. Here is the Greyhawk Events Discord. And if you want Greyhawk Online's Discord, just go to their website. For that link. So all of them are available at any point to give you some ideas of some great stuff that is in that is on the map. Really, really neat. Look at that, 9:52. Wow, that blew by.
Yeah.
That really blew by tonight.
Yeah, we had some side tricks.
But yeah, which is great.
We made it. We made it.
Some great discussion. And this kicks off a week of 4 streams. I thought I'm going to get 3 this week, but I have 4 now. So
yeah.
But
hopefully it was a good discussion too.
It was awesome.
People enjoyed it. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Give us a synopsis. Go, Anna. Go for it. Of this discussion.
I must say it's one of these. It's long, winding, interesting, and like there's a lot of different themes and different geography, different types of biomes and whatnot. So it's definitely these mountains are places where you should go adventure sooner or later, so to speak, because there is a lot of potential and also an area I need to map better because it's the maps here are not up to snuff. So they're not good enough. So they're not up to a standard I want them to be. So this is an area where I think there's, from a cartography standpoint, more room for improvement than other areas. So mountains are definitely going to be more interesting with better ways of mapping them.
Okay. Mike?
Just to throw out another quick zinger to finish off my list.
Awesome.
Dragon Magazine 155, Snow Elves Live in Crystalmas Mountains.
Aha.
Ah, cool.
Who wrote that article?
I don't know.
Okay. I was wondering if there's anyone in the community.
I don't know. Just
yes,
I'm sure someone out there has it.
155. I can look it up in PDF. Snow Let's elves. See here. Yeah.
Very cool.
And so that puts them in very close proximity to the Valley Elves.
Wow.
So you would, you know, could work in some relation there, I guess.
Or a war. I'm just kidding.
Ah. Thanks, Justinians. Yeah.
Snarls are in Carlos' marginal heart of winter. Good.
There we go. Cool.
All right. So hopefully you enjoyed this discussion tonight. Let's do some quickie shout outs and then we'll do the giveaway. We'll find someone to raid into. I got, like I said, streaming Wednesday, Thursday, Saturday, Sunday coming up this week. So, yep. Mike, start us off. What do you got going on, man?
I currently have nothing going on. I'm just gearing up for GaryCon. I have my usual games that I'm in. I'm in Rich's game. I'm in the Spelljammer game. And, you know.
Cool.
But looking forward to GaryCon. I'm involved in a lot of games myself. And hopefully I'll have enough energy to do some stuff later in the night. Yeah, correct.
We're going to be, we're all, like, everyone I know is extremely busy. Extremely busy during this, so yeah it's gonna be awesome.
My goal for this GaryCon is stay up past 11 because I don't think I stayed up very late because of that's how I'm used to, you know, because of work. So when I'm on vacation, I need to learn to stay up later and unwind. I used to be able to do that when me and Anna went to Gen Con all the time, you know, we could. But,
yeah, we sat, hang out, and babbled with a bunch
so
of people
far,
late in the evening. Yeah,
I'm just like I turn into a pumpkin.
We get older. The same thing.
Yeah,
me.
It's terrible.
You tire out. We're not 20 anymore. So yeah,
I set every morning as I'm DMing every morning Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So if I the night I can really I got nothing going on the Sunday we're late Saturday, but. If I stay up late,
you're running risk.
Friday night for the Ed Greenwood game Saturday morning. I mean, my gosh, I'm gonna be toast because that's what I'm gonna stream. So
yeah.
All my what for my he means PM. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I don't think I have that many early morning stuff, thankfully. So I think I'm have to look at my schedule, but I don't think it's that. Early in the morning, so yeah.
Well, yeah.
No, it's on Saturday, 9 in the morning.
The game.
That's the game. That's the only thing I have early in the morning. Otherwise, things are in the afternoon.
Central time, too, so yeah. It's not, yeah, so.
Well, it's early morning for me.
Yeah. What do you got going on, Anna?
What do I don't have going on? It's crazy times here. I'm trying to wrap up. I'm trying to do another. I hopefully can have a new of this going on. I'm trying to get this a new of this done and printed.
Yeah?
So there will be a new little teaser thingy. And if I can't have it printed, it will definitely be available as PDF and stuff. So when I'm doing my slides. So I think it will be cool so people can see in full quality in case the TV or the projector or something is crap, so to speak. That way I can show it off a little bit better. So I'm trying to get that done and have that printed. And I'm also helping Josh with doing stuff for the Greyhawk for the GaryCon convention itself with graphics and stuff too. And then it's doing all the stuff for my seminars and the fantasy mapping show and stuff like that. So and Altamira for Troll Lords and stuff. So that is almost done. The Troll Lord stuff, there is a couple of renders I want to do in order to do it, but I've done for my seminars, I'm probably about two-thirds done with all the stuff that I want to have in there, and there will be some new not seen stuff, so to speak. That's I wanted some new things that we haven't seen, and then there will be new takes on old stuff, so to speak. So hopefully there will be a little bit and on my seminar there will be a deep dive into some of the technology and some
when's
some,
your seminar?
Yeah. My seminar is after the game in the afternoon. It's 4 to 6 on Saturday. So yeah.
Okay. Let me try and catch some of that. That's right at the beginning of the right during the auction.
Okay. Well, there you go. Yep.
But yeah. So I'm gonna try and catch some of that too.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
So so there will be two. So I will get a chance to answer, probably answer even more questions, and also to do some more technological deep dives into methods and right. stuff like that. So that's what I want to put there, because that people are really interested in microtography can go to that seminar if they want to see more of the behind the scenes, more technical stuff and so on that we don't need to talk about during the Legends and Lore and stuff. We can
awesome.
Keep it a little bit less technical.
You and I need to talk about Fantasy Mapping Show too. Okay.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Right after this. Yep. Awesome, Anna. So here's what's going on next three of the next 4 days. So
we can mention on Friday, I will try and have a mapping live stream
Perfect.
On Friday
so
night too. So
I'm streaming that night. Perfect. So is there a virtual aspect of Gary Kahn for those that have to miss it? Oh, Arg Scott, I'm going to be on, I think, 7 to 8 times. I will provide a schedule coming up the end of next weekend. All right? I'll have banners and everything. I'll pop them all up in the Discords or pop them all up, and you'll know when it's going to be running. So what's going on when. Some of them are in the day because some of the stuff is just happens to be, you know, daytime seminars. So, I'll give it to you. Gary Kahn channel is probably supposedly, but I'm not sure if they're going to do that. So, all right, tomorrow we continue the race to Krovis. So, if you were around at all, and you know, last week, the Strandkeep Castle was attacked by a bunch of elite ogres and Flynns, but that was a feint, and we actually had a PC die. PC death, a slay living spell cast from this witch doctor here, and Alan's character failed her save, but Fritz saved the day with a rare item, an elixir of life he had. But that person's still out of commission, but it was a death. It was all a feint to find something in the upper levels, and these are two Scarlet Brotherhood monks. We're running out of space up here. They killed two Scarlet Brotherhood assassins. They found the item. There is no symbol for Krovis anywhere. Even Joe Block doesn't have one, so I had to make one up. So I made up and his symbols of his weapons, a bastard sword wrapped with vines. I did. And then Tim said, well, bastard swords didn't exist thousands of years ago. I said, Tim, it's not technological. It's fantasy. Sword and a half, right? So, yeah, that's what I did there. So that's we'll see what happens from there. But they found this brooch they think is of this deed. It's long... hero deity, long rest buried or long in the ground for some reason. So that is tomorrow night. And so I was not going to stream a game, and then it just came together. So Saturday nights we have a special event, and it's a part of Springtide Game Fest. And look at the players we have in this. So, Mike Disney's playing Skarn, okay? So, and he's the main character. It's all at Wolfmaster Castle. So, I use Strandkeep and Wolfmaster is the same thing. So, you'll see that big building up. It's the two I used it for. Darling Creepshow is playing the legendary gnome illusionist thief, Phil Mafani. Yes. All right. Rob Phantom New Jersey is playing Durgrim, his dwarf fighter thief. Heather Hex returns her snooty gray elven noble elven cavalier class, and then a brand new player, Little Bird 84, first time ever playing. She is playing a half elf cleric mage with a surprise here. Lairdia of House Vix Drolan. So there you go. So cleric mage class. So yep, we'll have some fun with that. That'll be a blast. I didn't make the name up. Darling did. So you're going to be hit on Heather's, or are you going to hit... Larger's got better comeliness than Heather's character. So there you go. You'll have to make those decisions, Darling. It'll be... Phil will have to make... it'll be a fun adventure. So that'll be... this came together quick. I was... we're doing our 13th ever DM's Roundtable Sunday night. John Birchfield was immediately said yes. a nerdy guide to D&D. It's four of them, and Lily is their DM, and she's from the UK. And they interviewed me last Sunday, and it went great. And I said, "Look, I'm trying to get number one. I'm gonna play. I'm gonna DM for them in April in the morning, a Saturday morning, and we'll live stream that for the four of them." But the I said, "Well, look, you're a DM, and we use different experience levels for people. Why don't you come on, give your perspectives?" And then I was like, "Who am I gonna get as my third person?" I said, "You know what? It's before Gary comes. Let's see if Todd's available. Star Trek Picard, he's lying on a gurney. If you saw, oh, sorry, from last week. So he's not. I know it's filmed way ahead. But so, and Todd's like, "Oh, this sounds great. I'm in." So I got Todd, yes. Oh, he doesn't. Hey, watch it then. Spoilers. Watch it on time then, Casey. Watch the show on time. So, but, you know, I have no idea what happens to him. He plays. All right, cool. He plays
such, just busting you.
Todd is great at playing a jerk. Captain Shaw is just hysterical. But Todd is on, and he's a great DM, too. What a discussion we're going to have. The main topic, challenges of running a D&D campaign. But we can ask any questions, all right? And that's from 7 to 9. So, yeah, and that'll be... that'll be a fun one. That'll finish up the week, and then next week I'm definitely only doing three streams because it's the week leading into Gary Con and I, you know, family time and stuff like that. So, there we go. Phil is an equal opportunity man. So you got two ladies in the group out of five. I mean, you got three female players, but two lady characters, both equally nicely attractive. A gray elf and a half elf. Phil, have at it. As you're investigating some of the low road there, it's called the Mother Load, so you can figure that one out there. And I'm always in one Phil, right? I'm just kidding. All right, so last call, and then we'll raid into the Mandy.
Yeah, good. Yeah, thank everyone for stopping by and watching. And thank you, Jay and Mike. This was
yeah,
fun.
It's a great discussion. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Casey is trying to put together a Living Greyhawk 1 episode for next Wednesday.
Oh, good.
There won't be a Legends of Lore the Wednesday after. There'll be a special Gavin live from Gary Con, live from the Grand Geneva Lounge. All right. Time is variable depending on when I leave the museum, which will be live streamed before that. So it'll be, dude, I'll be live streaming a lot during at Gary Con. So. All right, here we go. I'm closing it out. And Baker, you got to get with me too, still. Because your win last week, you didn't. I know we had a wrong button. Closing it, the winner tonight is... Oh, okay. So LJ from the UK, I'll get with her and I'll get her something.
Wow.
Really cool. Mm-hmm. Awesome. So, will Phil sweep the leg? Phil's going to sweep something.
Okay.
Yeah. It's going to be a fun group, and a really all classes are covered, so they're really in good shape here. Yeah, LJ is one of the new people from the Nerdy Guide to D&D. So, grats. Yep. Let's raid into the Mandy, Mike, Anna. Another great show. Please, Anna, stick around. I want to just Gary Con chat with you. Mm-hmm. See you all tomorrow night, 7:30. Oh, it's going to be Gamescape 3D giveaways, plus for those who don't have a 3D printer, some Reaper minis as well. All right, so all right, see y'all tomorrow. Yeah, 56, and I'll see you. I'll be 56 in a day tomorrow. So there you go. Bye-bye. Of course,
happy birthday.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
All right, set the rate up. Thanks. And Bones, thank you so very much for the 5 gift subs. I really appreciate it. That was very kind. Oh my gosh, I'm hitting the wrong buttons here. Not in the stream, outside the stream. I'm just trying to get to the raid screen. Give me one sec, please. Hi. There it goes. Nice numbers. Wow. 79, yeah. 81. Thanks. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. See you tomorrow night.
84. That's not bad. Yep.
And this.